we can't know everything, and so we have to rely on other people for some information. And we've got different ways of determining who's an authority and who's going to help us. The first is what we call control people. I'll explain that a little further in a little bit. But these are people that are giving you a message, whether you like it or not, and then you have to decide whether it's something that benefits you. And some authorities we will accept if we choose that we want to believe them for whatever reason. There are those that add value to our lives. You know, hopefully your lawyer, your doctor. But the humanist will always retain the right to test and doubt whatever it is they're being told. A lot of people in our society don't do that. If somebody told them something, they're going to believe it, and there's no buts about it. They'll accept it because that person has authority, and therefore they're not going to challenge them. And we find an awful lot of that within the Catholic faith. The next means that humanists find more acceptable yet is logic. And that's because they can relate what's happening and what they're talking about to some prior experiences that they've had that they've validated for themselves. And or they're attempting to add this new information to that to make sense out of it so they can determine whether they're accepting it or not. But they also recognize that that knowledge is only tentative. There are no absolutes. And the third means that humanists find acceptable is science, and that's because that's most apt to be true. And why is that the case? Scientists see a phenomenon occur, they wonder why. They develop a hypothesis as to why something happened. They test it. They create a theory then as to how it occurs, and that has to be able to be duplicated by other people. If that occurs, it can become accepted as a belief, subject to continued challenge on deeper levels of science into the future, and scientists are constantly testing each other's thinking. Albert Einstein was a humanist, created the theory of relativity. It finally became accepted as a fact, but it was only accepted 100 years later. Anyway, he wasn't here to appreciate the fact that he's finally a fact instead of a theory. Our reality differs between us because even though as humanists and we have the same means of determining truth, we will deal with the same issues in much the same way, but we might express them totally different, and that's okay. Nobody's here telling you what you must believe as a humanist. But we do find some level of common agreement, but we don't have to have a control person that is giving us that message. Let's talk a little bit about why we're living and what it means and what we can do about it, particularly since most of us have the conclusion that there's no life after death. Therefore, the only thing we can do is maximize the quality of our life while we're here living. The only science that I can find anyway that deals with this subject is the science of psychology. Psychology is the study of behavior. And it started with Sigmund Freud. What Freud did is he took people that had abnormal behavior, that, you know, they just weren't accepted in society, they were doing weird things. And he tried through psychotherapy to underpin these people, to bring them back into the mainstream of society. It was a fledgling science at that time. A lot of it's been discounted since, but he made quite a living out of it. The first real, what I would call science, was developed by behaviorists. Most of us have heard of Pavlov's dog. What Pavlov's dog did that is important in science is that the scientist that was testing him would ring a bell and give him food, and the dog would salivate. And he'd keep doing that until the dog associated the ringing of the bell with food. And when he then rang the bell and there was no food, the dog still salivated. So what that shows from a psychology perspective, and that's my background, by the way, is that behavior can be conditioned. And if it can be conditioned, that means you can change negative behavior with some kind of positive structure. That was developed further by another humanist by the name of B.F. Skinner. Skinner did amplify this theory by determining whether or not a person is rewarded or punished, and what that does to develop the conditioning that we allow for creating change. Interestingly enough, Skinner was a member of the American Humanist Association, but so was Abraham Maslow. Maslow developed the third level of psychology called humanistic psychology. And the interesting thing is, Ed Wilson was the first executive director of the American Humanist Association, hired by Reese and Dietrich. He was a minister in Yellow Springs, Ohio, so that became the first headquarters of the American Humanist Association. But when I was president of the American Humanist Association, back in 1980 through 84, Ed was on my board. And he tells me the story that after one of the meetings, he sat on a bar stool between Skinner and Maslow where they were arguing over their philosophy of humanism. I would have given anything to have been a mouse in the corner to hear that discussion, because I'm sure it got heated. But because they have totally different views. Frankly, I didn't know about, I knew of Skinner. I did not know of Maslow back when I was majoring in psychology. Almost everything I'm giving you today I've learned since, because I've taken quite a bit of work in addition. In fact, I belong to the American Humanist Psychological Association just so that I could try and learn more about Maslow. What Maslow did with behaviorism, what you're measuring is that if there's a need deprivation, your behavior will seek the solution of that deprivation, whatever it takes. And Maslow was trying to figure out how two of his professors were such beautiful people when he couldn't find any need deprivation that was causing that behavior. And so he came to the conclusion that maybe psychology has the theory of behavior backwards, that your objective is to have no need deprivation, and to the extent you have need deprivation, your behavior becomes more pronounced. Clearly, you get to the point of the people that Freud was dealing with. And so he got to thinking about, okay, then what are needs? You know, how do we put this together so that we can make some sense out of it? And what he discovered is that needs can be categorized by the degree of their need deprivation. And if you've got some kind of strong need, you then could wind up being the kind of person that Freud was dealing with. But if you're totally a healthy person like these two professors, you may not have any need deprivation at all. So what he found was that basic needs are those that are life dealing with life-threatening situations or whatever it takes for you to exist. And he found, you know, things like food, water, sleep, sex, warmth. If your behavior, I mean, if you're really got a deprivation in that area, your behavior is going to seek the solution to that to the exclusion of anything else. Once your needs on a basic level are satisfied, you move to the security level. And there what you're really doing is you're protecting yourself so those needs get satisfied the next time. And as I say here, you're feathering your nest. You want to feel safe and secure. You don't want to feel threatened by outside forces. Each of these levels differ by almost 50%. Now it's true that, you know, if you're a teenage kid with hormones, sex is probably more important than food and water for you, but The point is, the total level of that need categorized, sure, it's a gradated scale, and it might be just a little bit of need versus a lot of need, but ultimately, if you're really dealing with a serious deprivation, that's the level that he was measuring. The security level, sure, once they're satisfied, you can worry about what happens next, but that drive level is significantly lower. Once you feel secure, then you move to the social level, and here, what you're doing is you're bringing other people in within your defense mechanisms. So we don't have time to go into what defense mechanisms are, but in your security level, your defense mechanisms are a pretty important part of how you protect yourself from the threats that are, you know, going to cause you a problem. So when you bring other people within your defense mechanism, like family, their needs become your needs, and so you work collectively together to solve those problems. On that level, frankly, is where love first shows up. And interestingly enough, what love means is a recognition of your inner need dependence with other people. And at some point in time, it can be strong enough where that person's life has greater value than your own, such as a mother versus their child. Once you are satisfied on the social level, you move outward for recognition to validate yourself. And those are called ego needs. Once you really feel validated and comfortable, you can move to the top level, which is that of actualization. At that point, what you're really doing is you're becoming in tune with the reality around you. I explain all of this in a little more detail in my book, but Maslow had 15 different definitions for what it means to be on the actualized level. And your objective in life is to get there, to as you maximize your life. You'll know that you've gotten there when you have what's called a peak experience. And what a peak experience actually means is that if you kind of look at like a boat plowing through the water, all of a sudden the boat gets up on a plane and it moves much easier and it takes less energy and everything just feels right with it. There may be points in your own life where you just really feel good. You're not driven by any need to do anything. You're just very comfortable and very happy. That moment could be a peak experience. On the other hand, Maslow also thought the born-again experience for a Christian evangelist may well be a peak experience that they're having. And I thought that's kind of interesting. We all, I think, can agree with this, that one purpose for having a full life is that people ought to be able to live whatever way they deem appropriate to maximize their own existence. And we should be fairly tolerant as humanists. For me, I've got two things that I think my behavior centers around. One of those two objectives that Roby was mentioning here a little bit ago. The first is your life is meaningful to yourself to the extent you're able to actualize your own existence so you can get to that top point. But secondly, your life is significant to the extent the world's a better place because you've been here, and the healthy person will keep both in balance, frankly, and that's the only way we have what is validly immortality for a humanist. Let's talk a little bit about this scale here. You'll notice that it's a pyramid, and the reason for it is the strength level of these needs diminish just about on that curve. And also, what Maslow discovered is the population of the world pretty well fits within those levels, because people will live primarily on only one of these levels at a time. Although if you're on the social level, obviously you've got security needs, you've got basic needs, but you might not be able to rise above that. And why that's important, we'll get to in a minute, but I need you to realize that people, the masses of the world, religion fills the void of the social and the security level. And if you, I'll talk about it a little bit, but that's the social glue that keeps our society functioning. Humanism actually starts about halfway up on the social level and goes up through the actualized level. So we speak a different language, we've got different value system, living on different levels than most of the people that are dealing with religion. And the problem that we've got for the American Humanist Association at the moment that I'd like to address is that we as humanists can't fill that space. Now, when you look over on the right side, you'll see that behavior is almost totally selfish until somewhere around the mid-actualized point, and from then on it can become altruistic. There's some degree of selfishness. Obviously, if you're really hungry, you may steal the food from the person next to you. So your selfishness would be more predominant on that level than it is as you move up, but it's still, most of your motive is from a selfish perspective. Once you can get past the peak experience, some people dedicate their life for others, some way or another, and feel fulfilled because of that. That's really the maximum of life that Maslow's describing and the reason for why we should live. Now let's talk about religion for a moment. Why do we even have it? E.O. Wilson was a social biologist at Harvard. Most of his study was ants, actually. What he determined is that biology doesn't end at the point of birth and sociology take place on everything above that, that many of our cultural institutions are biologically determined. For instance, he points out that spirituality is a need that everybody has one way or another. But then he goes on to say something that I think is rather important here. He points out that from the time of hunter-gatherers clear down through about 15,000 years ago, when society started to become agrarian and domesticating animals, people lived in small groups of about 150 or less. At 150, the group itself can control the population. But when you get above that level, people don't know each other anymore, and you've got to have a social system that allows larger groups of people to be able to live together. So religion was created to fill that gap, to fill that need. And if you've ever studied the community of summer, which is in, between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, about the size of Massachusetts, each community there, each city, had its own temple and its own god. And when they go to battle, it was that god that was taking them, and so the gods were fighting each other. But the point is, it was the religious glue that allowed that society to exist. Not only did religion was created to fill that role, but control people were empowered to administer religion. And interestingly enough, when you study ancient Greeks, excuse me, it was the pharaohs that were appointed by the priests, that because that was speaking to say that God empowered that priest to act. So the power came from the top down and not from the bottom up. And so the priest became just about as powerful as the pharaoh. In fact, the pharaoh was in Memphis and the priest was in Thebes intentionally, so their paths weren't conflicting with each other. But that was how their society was organized. And we still see this within the Catholic Church today. Some of these control people rule by fear and reward, and that's, of course, where the concepts of heaven and hell came. That's an interesting study of itself. First, we had a hell and no heaven. What really created Christianity was when Paul started the message that Christ had arisen and gone to heaven, And all it took was that you had to say you believed in him as the path to get there, because the Jewish community that they lived in at that time had the belief that you only went to heaven at the end of days. And if you go to Jerusalem, you'll see that everybody's buried facing Mount Moriah there, because that's where Abraham was to have killed, we say Isaac. The Arabs don't agree with that. They claim that it was Hagar's son, Ishmael, because that child was born before the child of the marriage that we all claim. And so that's the holy site where God first spoke to a man, and that's the site where Abraham then was going to kill his son, but didn't. It replaced because some goat shows up, so they sacrificed the goat. That's the place where King David built the first Jewish temple, the house of the Lord. That's the place the Babylonians tore down, and yet Herod rebuilt that. That's the church that Christ knew. When the Israelis were kicked out of Israel, the Jews were, the Arabs moved in. I claim that the king then realized that he had to have a tourist trap because his people were saving up their money to go to Mecca during their life and taking their riches out of the community. And so he reads in the Quran that Muhammad on his horse went to heaven at the corner of the universe, and he points to Mount Moriah where the Jewish temple had sat and says, and there's the footprint. And so the Arabs built the third most important mosque of all of Islam at that spot, and that's the gold dome you see today above Jerusalem. So the Jews are praying to the Western Wall because there's a sign when you go up the ramp that says the Orthodox Jew can't pass this point because that 46 acres up there has been desecrated by people of Islam faith. So they're praying to the side wall saying, get off our mountains, you sons of bitches, you know, because... In fact, they even put prayers in the stones, and these stones are as big as boxcars, and yet it was built by Herod over 2,000 years ago. We got off the subject. The problem that we're dealing with is that the belief of a life after death now has become a meme. It's a cultural tradition. Oh, thank you. I was supposed to have lunch, and I went down to this thing out on the courtyard, and 45 minutes later, food hadn't showed up, and so this is lunch. Let's talk about memes now, because that's a pretty important concept. This is something that was really created about 30 years ago by Richard Dawkins, who's an Oxford professor that is very active in humanism. In fact, he belongs to the board of Paul Kurtz's organization up in Amherst, and has dedicated all of his writings and everything he has in his library, his history, to that organization. We believe that life after death really doesn't exist because there is no evidence. It's something that we're simply told, but we still may have a wish to want to believe, and the question is why. We got to remember that all people live predominantly on one level, and once you understand Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you can pretty well determine that when you're talking to people. In fact, Maslow, in order to determine whether people could actualize, used two tests. One was music, and one was humor. People on the ego level and above can handle Beethoven real well. They might also like hard rock, but person living on the basic level can only accept hard rock as comfortable for themselves, which explains why kids listen to that sort of stuff and you wonder why. But jokes are the same thing. People on a basic level have to have violence or sex or something related to their joke for it to be humorous to them. People jokes can be humorous to somebody on the social level. Incongruency could be humorous to somebody on the actualized level. The person on the basic level would never understand why something incongruent could be funny. But it was his way of trying to determine the people he wanted to talk to, because he wanted to talk to those that really were able to actualize their own existence. The purpose of higher education is to allow people to grow to the upper levels by providing them a vision without any barriers. In other words, the only way you can get around a barrier is through some educational bridge. Accepting of humanism starts at the mid-social level, as I said earlier. Most people in society fill their lower levels with religion. We can't really replace it until everyone has sufficient education to understand its meaning. Society probably can't reach that level during our lifetime. So I'm suggesting that it be worth the effort for humanists to provide the framework to allow that to occur. And that could become a goal of the American Humanist Association. Let's talk about really what needs are. When you take any need, let's say it's the deprivation of water, if you're really thirsty, you're closer to the pain level. If you look at this arc with the node at the top, you drink a little water, you're moving up that scale. You get to the top where you're fully satisfied, you curve off, and if you drink a little more water, you get into the node. If you keep drinking water, you get a little high again, and then it drops off and you go back to pain. So you can have pain with too much water or too little. That works the same way for all of our needs. Now, I realize that security and social are reversed on this side, but this is in the HA's computer and I can't reverse those two. But what happens when you're born is you're pretty much on the basic level. The child, as it gets older, gets up into the security level, hopefully gets to the social level, but at some point in time, it could be a parent, it could be the priest, it could be whatever, could be the lack of confidence the person has and their child has, and nobody helps that person get over that because they haven't given the sufficient education to be able to do so. And so they've created a barrier that stops their growth. So their range of living can be pretty minimal. Now, these needs aren't structured on a straight line. They're on levels of plateaus, and there's a significant difference when you get to the next level, and you actually can feel that if you know what it is that you're looking for. The only way that you can get around these bridges is to back up into a safe area for that person, and then you build an educational bridge that doesn't address that barrier, that gets above it. And from then on, the person can grow without that need being a problem. And why that concept's important for you to know is that some of the things that we do, we run smack into that barrier. And when you do that, you can't penetrate it, because that person has what we call a scotoma. What a scotoma means is that once you have sufficient information that you feel that you're comfortable with, whatever it might be, you start building a wall around that information so that it works like a spam blocker in a computer, so that anything that's challenging that can't get through. And people, as they age, these scotomas become pretty pronounced. And so a person that has a religious belief that was created earlier before their age of reason and has emotions tied to it, and you try and challenge them on that level, you keep in mind they're on the security level or low social level, and on those levels, when you challenge something, people get violent. And that's the behavior that you see coming from people when we go tell them God doesn't exist, so forget it, you know. It doesn't work, but you could go around it if you never talked about God and show them why that's not a relevant issue for them anymore, and they'll grow out of it on their own. Beliefs that are created before the age of reason, this is the reason the Catholic Church has a school system. You capture that child before they can think, and you tell them what their beliefs are. They build scotomas around them, and you can't convince them for anything else. And this is one reason why all of us in this room that were raised in some form of a Christian orientation or some other faith have trouble breaking away without some sense of guilt. And you've got to overcome that. You only do that with education. It takes a heck of a lot of effort to become a humanist because our society fights that pretty definitely. Now, there's a lot of reasons for barriers. Some are these that are created before the age of belief. Some are by control people conditioning. Some are because the person simply lacks enough information to make sense out of it. Some of it's because we have limited resources for fulfilling lower needs, and if that's true, you're going to fill those needs, and you're not going to worry about it, just like the person that's got a basic need isn't going to worry about Beethoven. Let's talk about who control people are. There's lots of different forms that control people. Some are controlled by law. Our Constitution creates a system so that we can all live together in society, and so we have presidents and governors and military leaders, judges, and wardens, and you try and tell any of them they don't have power, and they'll prove to you that they do. Some are controlled by relationships, like a parent and child or a school teacher. Some by consent, your lawyer and your doctor. Some because of benefit, quite a range here, from spouse to employer to your bartender. Some by demand, motivated by fear of reward, and you see that with police and priests. These are all control people on different levels, and we respond to them in different ways. My objective today is to point out that, you know, your job is to figure out what's their motive for control and whether or not you want to accept it or whether you don't. But you've got to recognize that everybody else in society is dealing with these same issues. So unless you approach these people in ways that protect them from the control people that are causing what you consider to be a problem, you're never going to get anywhere. Let's talk about what God is and what it means to people. Maslow tells us that people living primarily on a range from basic to wherever their environment has allowed them to reach will have different God concepts. On the basic level, people have to have a fear God concept in order to be able to understand and appreciate that God. By the time they get to a social level, they could have a father God concept. By the time they get to the actualized level, typically their God concept becomes abstract. Some on that level might think nature is God. I've had some people tell me love is God. There's a Unitarian minister by the name of Wyman that thought the life force, what caused life to be able to exist itself, must be God. The problem that you have when, as an atheist, if you're promoting that statement, is that you got to have a social level or below God in order to be an atheist, because how can you deny nature? I pointed out earlier about what Wilson says, what the purpose for religion is, and what I'm suggesting is that if you really think about that, we shouldn't be attacking religion, because to do that, you could wind up with a society that didn't have the social glue anymore, and you could have anarchy as a result, as opposed to having a civilization. If you really played that to its fullest, you'd never be able to actualize, because you'd be living on the security level to protect yourself from everybody else. And at that point in time, nobody would get to the point of actualization. So pulling the social glue out of the middle of society is not a good idea. You got to recognize that most people with their religion go for security and social reasons. It has absolutely nothing to do with the myth that centralizes the lessons of the church. And that's one reason why I think that even, well, we'll get to it. Paul Tillich has kind of an interesting idea. He was the dean of theology at the University of Chicago. And he had the notion that your God is your ultimate concern, whatever drives you as a person. We each create our own God, according to Tillich. Typically, it's whatever we fear or revere. Some people are driven by money. Even atheists believe in money. Atheists just not like the use of the word God associated with anything. Most humanists agree because we don't want to be led by outside forces, and so we can agree that God isn't particularly relevant to us. But to attract people to humanism, you've got to build a bridge around these religious memes with non-threatening education, because nothing else will work, or you'll hit a scotoma, all you'll do is get violence, and you'll never win. The ancients thought that there had to be an outside force controlling their life. They labeled this God because that's the only thing they could understand. So the term God has become a cultural meme. So challenging the meme becomes a scotoma, and you can't hit it directly. What a meme is, it works like a gene. Darwin proved that life is dependent upon the evolution of the gene rather than the evolution of you as a person. A gene becomes a self-fulfilling, replicating entity. We modify it during our lifetime, lots of ways that genes evolve. Memes are the same thing. Memes are an idea, something that you hear that you can't get out of your head, so you accept it or you have a belief, or at least you deal with it. There's a meme for you. Who here has not heard of Ring Around the Rosy? I don't see a single hand. How did you learn that? Your parents didn't teach you, other kids taught you. Other kids taught you because it has an action step in it, and it's fun, so they repeat it. So it passes from brain to brain. But why on earth would you want to celebrate the bubonic plague that occurred in England 700 years ago and teach your kid that? The point is you don't, but that is a true example of a meme. Who's been to Disney World and been on this ride, It's a Small World After All? You can't get that damn song out of your head for months, even though you really hated it while you heard it and you still don't like it. It's there. There's all kinds of memes. Actually, the practice of law, architecture, medicine, these are really all memes. They evolve with further knowledge. But you firmly believe in wherever it is that you are on that scale, because that's what you've learned to accept. They're self-replicating. Memes pass directly from brain to brain, and since others we respect communicate that thought, we believe it must be true. They simply incorporate challenges of their detractors, but they don't go away. So we can change the meme, but we've got to do it through education. They evolve, you can't kill them with any contrary thought. Memes adapt, but memes cannot be eliminated by a direct attack. Therefore, memes simply cannot be extinguished by those who challenge their concept, and that's why, starting from an atheist perspective and dealing with the religious question, is doomed to fail. The only thing that will work is non-threatening education. And I think, and I'm about done with my time, so I'm going to kind of hurry. Our founding fathers were deists. They certainly were not theists, and there's a big difference. Theism is religious means of control by adding supernaturalism to the God concept, and humanists would find no reason for supernaturalism. So many of us are anti-theists. Some are atheists. Some are simply agnostic and don't care. We've got the whole range in our organization. I've had quite a few experiences with people that I've been trying to bring into the fold. And I had lunch Monday with a lawyer that I've talked to on several occasions. I know he's a humanist. He went on the web page for the AHA and he thought, all these atheists in there, he can't afford to associate with us because he doesn't want that image. We had in our humanist group in Des Moines a panel of the Iowa Atheist and our Humanist Association, and I was on that panel, and discussing philosophy. After that meeting, the doctors that are in our group quit and haven't come back. And that's because they can't afford to have their name associated with atheists because they're in a general practice and we're on the buckle of the Bible Belt out there. So there are ways that we can solve the problem without getting labeled with what is an in-your-face kind of approach that mainstream society avoids. Most of us realize that we don't want to have anything to do with an active, fundamental Christian because they're in-your-face kind of people, and so you avoid them. The problem is that we're having some of that same problems within the HA, but it's on the other end of the spectrum. I thought this is kind of interesting. I'm not going to go into this, but it's in my book. Bishop Spong, that we recognized in the HA, has a system that in essence makes Jesus into a humanist. And we could play off of that. And what you would find is that I think that could save mainstream religion, but it would be expressing humanism as their philosophy. He simply ties it together with the ancient memes that people believe and makes it relevant. And there's no question that Spong's a humanist. So if you want to read it, you got to buy my book. So I ran out of time. But if we did that, we could really strengthen the AHA significantly. And atheism and God really have little to do with the humanist message. We are good without God. Doesn't mean we have to keep waving the banner. By concentrating on the good that contributed to the lives of others, we can bring a lot more people into the American Humanist Association, because not only will we be more accepted, like Roy's done with Congress, now that we have three congressmen that have put together a caucus, that's really doing something. We can make a difference in the lives of others by being accepted. There are things we can do. I mean, you can make people define their God, and you'll find they don't know how unless someone tells them. Or you can challenge supernatural attributes to God, and it's perfectly acceptable, and yet you're not saying you're an atheist to get there. You're simply challenging him. That is the Achilles heel of religion. And it works a lot better than saying there's no God, so get over it, because you hit the people right in their scotoma. And it's not humanistic behavior, because we think people ought to be able to live whatever life they want to live on their own, whatever it takes to maximize their own life. This summarizes what I've been saying. There's a lot of ways we could build that bridge. This is an important thing to think about. Gandhi conquered India, controlled by the British military, without firing a shot, but he did it using the same technique that I'm talking about here to conquer religion. He simply pointed out what was good about what he was doing and said nothing else. It's pretty hard to shoot somebody when they're taking that kind of a posture. Others will soon follow us. Together we can change the world. Anyway, this is a thought for you, and my time is up.